Good morning and welcome to you all on this special occasion, on this quasi-monogenity divine service and also the ordination of Jacob Corzine.
Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Like newborn infants, hallelujah.
Long for the pure spiritual milk, hallelujah.
Sing aloud to God our strength.
Shout for joy to God our Jacob.
Glory
be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Yes.
Disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood amongst them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us respond now to the Word of God and unite in faith with the one Christian Church by confessing together the Nicene Creed. I believe in
one God, the Father of all mighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance.
Pretoria. According to apostolic practice, he is now presented to be ordained and consecrated to this office established by God. Before we start with this procedure, let us ask God, our Heavenly Father, for his assistance. Let us pray. Our Lord, Heavenly Father, we are in awe by the importance of your commission. In the power of your Holy Spirit, we are to be messengers and witnesses of your truth to the people in our time. When we look at ourselves and our lack of understanding and enthusiasm, we must despair because we do not have the ability to carry out your commission. However, we look to you and to your mercy, and thank you that you pour shepherds and teachers for your church and fill them with the power of your Spirit. Since you have commanded us to pray for faithful workers, we now ask you humbly and trustingly for your Holy Spirit, as we now ordain this brother to the holy office of the Church. Grant that he may preach your word with joyfulness and administer your sacraments with faithfulness, and so lead your flock on the way to eternal life. Amen. Let the congregation may be seated there. brothers and sisters in Christ, especially dear brother Jacob. Yeah, today, Father May, is a special day in our country, 27 years of democracy. But it is also a very special day, of course, in your own life. Today you are being called and you are to be ordained into the holy ministry. It is not a ministry designed by men, but it is instituted by the Lord of the Church himself. Later on in the service, you will make various pledges, in particular that you will remain faithful to the scriptures as the inspired word of God, and also to the Lutheran confessions as its correct and proper understanding. This is important because indeed they constitute the parameters in which you will do your work. In the next few years in Pretoria, you will be working primarily amongst the young people, which is very exciting. As we heard, you have been called to the service in the student ministry here in Pretoria. As with all ministries of the church, this one will also be quite a challenging task. In fact, it might be especially challenging as our Lutheran churches here in South Africa have never embarked on a student ministry before. You are therefore treading on a new ground, and as churches in South Africa, we are very grateful that you have accepted this calling. You are, of course, Jacob, a learned person, academically well prepared for the ministry. You have not only completed your basic studies in theology, but you've also done a doctorate in theology. And that is something to be proud of, a North American who did a doctorate in Germany, something which I wouldn't have managed myself. But against this background, I would like to draw your attention today to something quite different. I intend to focus on the practical side of being a pastor and the practical side of being a missionary. It is always exciting to start something new, and as I noted already, especially exciting to work amongst the young people. And usually we enter the harvest field of God with great anticipation, and rightly so, because we've got a wonderful message to bring. But the excitement that we as ministers have is not always shared by those whom we are trying to reach. And as a result, one of the greatest dangers that we as pastors face is ambivalence. But then I mean a lack of anticipated success and sometimes downright failures on our part often lead us into a cold space. We lose the initial excitement, and after a while some of us pastors tend to go through the motions. Maybe we still concentrate on the pure preaching of God's word, but our heart isn't always there anymore. In short, we've lost the love for the people whom we've been called to serve. We are, as pastors, of course, not alone in this. It happens to people in all professions of life. In short, it would be great if doctors and nurses and teachers and artists and others would love the people they work with. But the fact is, they can perform the work without love and nevertheless do quite a good job. But this does not apply to the pastoral ministry. We cannot do any pastoral work without love. The pastoral ministry is love, which we apply within a series of tasks. Preaching, teaching, praying, or even doing church administration are nothing but the consistent application of God's love to the church. But as noted, sometimes when things don't go as we wish, ambivalence or indifference paralyze our work. And then somehow we need to rediscover and embrace all over again the love that comes from God. How? Let me read to you some verses from John's Gospel, chapter 15. Jesus says to his disciples, abide in me, and I will abide in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must abide in the vine. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Yet Jesus calls on his disciples, if they are to bear fruit, that they abide in him. But what does this mean practically? Jesus goes on and he says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now abide in my love. And then he adds, this is my commandment, love each other as I have loved you. This makes abiding in Christ something quite concrete and something quite practical. We abide in Christ by loving one another in the fellowship of believers. And this, by the way, becomes the characteristic that defines our relationship with God before others. In chapter 13 of John's Gospel, Jesus says, by this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Now sometimes we get it all wrong. Instead of knowing us by our love, we think that the world, or maybe even the people in our congregations, will know us by the many programs that we run. The fact is, the world doesn't really care about the programs that we run, and they run these programs usually far better than we do. What people in the world need is someone to love them under all circumstances. The world longs for a church of Christians where love constitutes the core and the essence. And we don't need to worry about offending the world with our doctrines, or offending the world maybe with our style of worship. What causes offense is fighting and lovelessness. Our ministry is a ministry of love. The problem we face, however, is that love is not something that we can simply choose. The burden of love is ultimately too heavy to carry, and under no circumstances can a pastor simply choose to love all of his parishioners. This is also not what Christ expects from us. His encouragement is simply to yield to him every day. That is why Jesus tells his disciples first to abide in him and then to love one another. Our choice is to abide in Christ. Or perhaps even better, it is Christ's choice that we should abide in him. And we know we can only love when we are loved first. This leads me to reflect on God's love. The Greek word used in John's Gospel is the word agape. Now this divine, unconditional love, so prevalent in Christ, who gave his life for us, is a very well-known word, and it's often preached upon. I would therefore like to backtrack to the Hebrew word for God's love in the Old Testament. The word that I'm referring to is the word in Hebrew, chesed. Now this is a beautiful word, and I believe it's more inspiring, really, than any other word in Scripture. It is somewhat of a flexible word, as it has various meanings and can be translated in various ways. It can mean love, or mercy, or kindness, or loyalty. But common to these meanings is a covenant that is being kept. In legal terms, it is about promise keeping, even if the other party has violated the promise. Now, the New International Version, which we tend to use in our church services most of the time, translates this word simply as love. The Revised Standard Version translates steadfast love, which is a good translation. The King James Version uses both mercy and kindness. But then the Bible translators have come up with the best neologism in the history, I believe, of the English language. Chesed is translated as loving kindness. And this word features all over in the Old Testament. King David, for example, writes, "Because of thy loving kindness, Kizit, is better than life. My lips shall therefore praise you." Kizit is the long and stubborn love of a God who remains faithful to us, although we have long forfeited our right to remain in covenant with him. And this love forms the basis also of the new covenant, Christ to reconcile the world to himself. And maybe the greatest spiritual issue between a pastor and his congregation, or those whom he wants to reach with the gospel, is whether there is a bond, whether a bond has been formed between them or not, whether there is kizit. And that is what I'd like to convey to you on the day of your ordination. Preach the cross of Christ, administer the sacraments in all purity, but remember, if there is no kizit, remember, if there is no love, there is really nothing. And kizit grows on us when we look away from ourselves, when we look away from our own abilities and achievements, but also from our disappointments and our failures, and simply abide in Christ, the one who loves us stubbornly. As you follow God's call, remember this word, kizit. In Christ, God loves you, and through you, he wants to love many others. And this can only happen when you abide, when you remain in the Lord. Amen. Let us now sing the next hymn.
All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I will be with you always, to the very end of the age. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. And if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," said he. "You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep."
The Apostle Paul writes in his second letter to the Corinthians in the 5th chapter, "God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." In the letter to the Ephesians, it is written, "It was he who gave some to the apostles, some to the prophets, some to the evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ." Paul writes also in his first letter to Timothy, chapter 3 and 4, "Here is a trustworthy saying: if anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. And set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity."
Dear brother, in these words of Holy Scripture, you have heard what we who have been called to the office of the Church are required to do. Therefore, I ask you, do you believe and confess the canonical books of the Old and New Testament to be the inspired Word of God and the only infallible rule of faith and practice?
Yes, I believe and confess.
Do you believe and confess that the confessions of the Evangelical Lutheran Church, namely the Apostles, the Nicene, and the Athanasian Creeds, the unaltered Augsburg Confession and its Apology, the Large and Small Catechism of Dr. Martin Luther, the Small Cult Articles, and the Formula of Concord, to be a true exposition of Holy Scripture?
Yes, I believe and confess.
Do you promise to perform the duties of the office in accordance with Holy Scripture and these confessions with the ability which God presents in Jesus Christ our Lord?
Yes, I promise, with the help of God.
Will you minister faithfully to all those entrusted to you and instruct both young and old in the chief articles of Christian doctrine? Will you forgive the sins of those who repent Then will you promise never to disclose the sins confessed to you?
Yes, I will, with the help of God.
Finally, will you strive to honor and adorn the office of the Holy Ministry with a holy life? Will you diligently study Holy Scripture and pray for those under your pastoral care?
Yes, I will, the Lord helping me through the power and grace of His Holy Spirit.
Merciful God, Heavenly Father, you spoke through your own dear Son, saying that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers few, and that we should ask you, the Lord of the harvest, to send laborers into your harvest. Hear now our prayer on behalf of Jacob Corzine, who is to be ordained and consecrated to be your minister in the church. Grant him your power that he may take up the word of truth and faithfully to administer your holy sacraments. O Lord Jesus Christ, fill him with your love and grant him a heart for your people. Help him serve your people with gentleness and wisdom, that in your name he will seek the straying and be up to me. O Holy Spirit, strengthen and keep him in the word of truth and life, and support him in time of trouble and distress, that he will not grow weary in his calling. To you, God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor, both now and forever. Amen. Dear brother Jacob Allan Corzine, in the authority which Jesus Christ has given his church, I hereby ordain and consecrate you to the office of the Holy Ministry of the Word and Sacrament in the one holy Christian and Apostolic Church. Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. In the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord Jesus pour out on you his Holy Spirit for this office, and work that you may faithfully preach the gospel and administer the sacraments. Amen. Join me in speaking with us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
God's word from Isaiah 41. Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous hand.
The words of the Apostle Paul from 2 Timothy 2:19. To show yourself approved, a workman who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth.
hear words from Psalm 73. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all his words.
From Acts chapter 18, do not be afraid, but speak, and do not be silent. For I am with you, and no one will lay a hand on you to harm you. For there are many in the city who are my people. Amen.
How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Isaiah 52, verse 7. From the book of Joshua, be strong and courageous, do not be frightened, and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go.
St. Paul in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 2, verse 2. I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Jesus Christ and him crucified.
St. Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 3. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory.
Psalm 119:76. Let your steadfast love comfort me, O Lord, according to your promise to your servant.
Your pastor, Jacob Corzine.
Dear brother Corzine, listen to the word from Martin Luther concerning the office of the Holy Ministry. Preach nothing but the wisdom of the cross.
2 Corinthians chapter 4. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with grace, patience, and careful instruction. Amen.
Apostle Jacob is in. Go now in the peace of the Lord and serve faithfully all those entrusted to you. Amen.
Oh.
May the Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless and keep you to life everlasting. Amen.
Hear the word of the Lord, the text for this sermon, as it is written in Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their hosts by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Have you ever actually tried to count the stars? I mean, on a really clear, dark night. I know that a lot of you know what a night like that looks like. Where anywhere you look in the sky, it seems like it's just bursting with stars. Have you ever tried to count them? You can't. Any of you who have seen a night like that know you wouldn't even know how to start counting the stars. It's far too daunting of a task. What we can do is be in awe of the stars, be in awe of the creator of the stars, but to count them is simply not something we're in a position to do. There's only one who can count the stars. Isaiah reminds us of that here, our God who created them. The prophet Isaiah called the people of Israel to look up to the stars and consider who could count them. He wanted to remind them of the difference between their God and the way they thought their God was, and the human helpers they had sought in place of their God. He wanted to remind them how much more God is able to help them than they could ever imagine. He wanted to remind them that God does not grow weary of helping them or disinterested in their need.
And he wanted to remind them that God gives them strength when they rely on him. First, God is able to help us. We can be thankful that we don't need to count the stars, because we don't really have any very precise way of doing it. And by that, I don't just mean me, who doesn't really know anything about astronomy. Even the astronomers are pretty limited in their ability to count the stars. Now, we know much, much more about the stars than Isaiah did. We know they're grouped into galaxies. We know there are way, way more stars in the sky than the ones that we can actually see. But to get a precise number of how many there are, we're a long way off from that. Now, again, we're making progress, but if it finally comes down to this task, the astronomers will always fail us on the exact number. They'll get better, and so we trust them and count on them, but their answers remain estimates. Only God knows how many stars there are. Only God is able to count them. And we can be thankful that we don't need to count the stars. But there are all kinds of other things in our lives that we do need to accomplish, that we do need to work through, to deal with, to manage, and they seem just as impossible as counting the stars. No man can give us the help that we truly need, but only God alone. This is what Isaiah would have us remember here. God truly is able to help us. And this counts in the most hopeless of situations. The people to whom Isaiah was preaching were in a completely hopeless situation. Their nation was being tossed back and forth by one foreign occupying power to the next. Their kings were weak, foolish, and sometimes downright evil, and they were suffering the consequences. And as the next nation, Babylon, prepared to march in, things seemed hopeless. And it was then that Isaiah called them to look up to the stars and to remember that the God who created those stars was their God and that he could help. These words are truly for us today as well. It's never so hopeless that God can't help. It often seems so, but there's no prayer he can't answer, no relationship he can't mend, no sin he can't forgive. Look up at the sky and remember that he created the stars. And if you doubt that he also wants to come to your aid today, remember this. Isaiah didn't just preach comfort, he preached repentance. He preached to sinners, just like I do today. He would have us repent of the sin of trusting in men instead of God, the sin of growing impatient with God, of believing something about God that the scriptures don't tell us, namely, that he's not active in our lives. Of the sin of turning away from the gospel of Jesus Christ to something that seems more effective. Of the sin of turning away from the gospel of Jesus Christ to something that seems easier to swallow. Of the sin of believing that because we don't deserve his grace and love, we don't receive it. God would have us repent of the sin of doubting in him. He would have us turn back and trust him. Look at the stars. The God who created the stars promises never to betray you. The sins of God's people then weren't that different than they are today. And God did not respond by turning his back on them. Instead, he sent his son to death for us and for them and raised him back from the dead. This is how much he is willing to do for us and how powerful he is to actually do it. We can say it, with the resurrected Jesus as our Lord, there is no hopelessness anymore. But it's not just that God is able to help us. He also does not grow weary of helping us. And he also does not get uninterested in our need. A few nights ago, I went outside and took a look up at the stars, and I tried to count them. There were 12. It was the city lights, right? Pretoria lights the sky up so much that a lot of the stars just aren't bright enough to shine through so that you can see them. and the moon. It was almost a full moon, I think, that night, and the moon light rides up in the sky, especially right there, and around the moon there are no stars, because they aren't bright enough to shine past the moon. Finally, I think there were some clouds. The clouds cover up the stars, and it pretty much doesn't matter how bright the stars are, that they can't shine through the clouds. Of course, I knew that they were still there. They just become too hard to see. And it can seem this way with God's help at times. There are times when we look, and at best, if we squint our eyes closely and search very carefully, we can see a little bit of God's help. And if we look long enough, then it turns out that a lot of that is satellites and airplanes. Israel felt this way. Isaiah records their cry. My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. They couldn't see where God was helping them. They see rather that he was allowing them to suffer and ignoring their prayer. And when you can't see something that you think you should be able to see, then you begin to question whether it's really there at all. Seeing is believing, right? What happens if you can't see? And this is the next step. If you can't see and you begin to realize how much you need what you can't see, then you can begin to try to replace it. To place your trust that belongs in God, in men. It's not God that grows tired. We do. We grow tired of waiting on God. And then we begin to think differently about who he is and who he is for us. Now, I can't tell you why God sometimes makes us wait for his aid. Not any more than Isaiah could tell Israel. He can only tell them that God's understanding is unsearchable, that we are not wise enough to understand God's decisions. But I can tell you this. Appearances deceive. Simply because you can't see God working doesn't mean that he is not at work. So when you see and experience something other than what the scriptures teach us about God, hold fast to the scriptures. Remember the stars. Sometimes they're drowned out by the city lights, sometimes they're drowned out by the moon, and sometimes they're covered by a cloud, but they're always there. Sometimes the stars disappear entirely in the light of day, when the sun shines so bright that none of the stars are visible anymore at all. When you can't see any stars, remember this. The greatest aid God ever provided us was his son, Jesus Christ, the fair and bright morning star. Finally, God gives his strength to those who trust in him. It should be clear by now that it's better to place your trust in God than any man. I hope that you'll especially consider this as we look forward to the next few years of student ministry here in Pretoria. It might not ever be clearer than it is right now, after the ordination, that anything that I do, any success that the student ministry work has, relies entirely on God's blessing, and not on my strength, and not on yours, in assisting with the work. You've prayed that I would be faithful, that I would preach repentance and the forgiveness of sins in Jesus Christ and never sway from that. And I vow to do exactly that, to remain faithful to the scriptures and the Lutheran confessions. I can't do this without God's help. Please do not stop after the service to pray that he will provide that help. In so doing, we're praying for the success of this ministry, for the spread of the gospel and the creating and strengthening of faith among students here in Pretoria. This is our goal, and it's an entirely scriptural goal. And it will be reached by the Holy Spirit, who is the Lord and giver of life, as we say in the Nicene Creed. He converts through his word, and it's that word that I'm called to serve here in Pretoria. Isaiah promises that those who rely on God will receive strength. Even youth grow weary, he reminds us, but God gives endless strength. Let us rely on him. Let us continually commend the student ministry in Pretoria to God in prayer, confident that he didn't send his son to die in vain, but that people would be converted and come to the knowledge of the truth. If we do this, rely on God, before we rely on each other, He will give us strength. Strength to carry the gospel forward in Pretoria, strength to carry each other and bear with each other as we live together and work together here in Arcadia. It's the same trust and confidence from which God would have us draw strength for everything in our lives. Remember the Hebrews passage. We draw near to the throne of grace and confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Our confidence is in our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for all our sins, including those of doubt and mistrust, and rose for our salvation. He is the bright morning star. Some nights you'll go out and you'll only be able to count 12 stars, maybe fewer. It doesn't matter. Look to the cross. Amen. And the grace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, we give thanks for all your goodness and bless you for the love that sustains us from day to day. We praise you for the gift of your Son, our Savior, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, for your Holy Church, for the means of grace, for the lives of all faithful and just people, and for the hope of the life to come. Help us to treasure in our hearts all that you have done for us, and enable us to show our thankfulness in lives that are wholly given to your service. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Save and defend your whole church, purchased with the precious blood of Christ. Strengthen your faithful people through the word and the holy sacraments, making them perfect in love and in all good works, and establishing in them the faith once delivered to the saints. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant your wisdom and heavenly grace to all pastors and to those who hold office in your church, that by their devoted service, faith may abound and your kingdom increase. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In your mercy, strengthen newly established congregations and support them in challenging times. Make them steadfast, abounding in the work of the Lord, and let their faith and zeal for the gospel refresh and renew the witness of your people everywhere. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Preserve this nation in justice and honor, that we may lead a peaceable life with integrity. Grant health and favor to all who bear office in this land. Help them to serve this people according to your holy will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Take from us all hatred and prejudice. Give us the spirit of love and order our days in your peace. Prosper the labor of those who work to bring peace and justice to the nations of the world, that mutual understanding and common endeavor may be increased among all peoples. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sanctify our homes with your presence and bless them with joy. Keep our children in the covenant of their baptism and enable their parents to bring them up in lives of faith and devotion. Grant health to newborn children and their mothers and preserve them until their baptism. Unite the members of all families in a spirit of affection and service that they may show your praise in our land and in all the world. Lord, in your mercy, by your word and Holy Spirit, comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity, especially the Maponya family. Be with those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow, and grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you in your church on earth, who now rest from their labors. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints, and bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us. Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
For the
glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and for the sins of the world. By his dying he has destroyed death, and by his rising again he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Thank you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you